Thank you so much, Rajul, for this warm welcome. Colleagues and friends, I'm very pleased to address you today. I'm congratulating IFPI to this fabulous office and seminar facilities. This is a great leap forward from the humble small times, Rajul, which we shared at least three different addresses in Washington. It has gone up, up, and up. It seems the sky is the limit. Let me also at the outset welcome two senior colleagues in the audience, Professor Nurul Islam and Maria von Braun, my aunt. So youngsters, forgive me that I single out those who are having the experience. let me come to my little presentation. I double click here, is that what you want? Or Michael, would you go ahead? I picked a topic on purpose, which I feel is under-debated in the North American hemisphere. Actually, Canada is picking up on bioeconomy under its new premier, and is under-debated in the community of the consultative group of international agriculture research. To my knowledge, only SEAD has so far had events, seminars, debates on bioeconomy. So the talk is about new transformation of agriculture, food, and bio-based industries. And I talk a little bit about what this means for emerging economies. My hidden agenda is the last slide to invite you to the upcoming next Global Bioeconomy Summit, April 19, 20 in Berlin. We had a first, and that will be the second Global Bioeconomy Summit. At the first summit, we had about 700 people from 80 countries. Chancellor Merkel was the patroness of the event, and we have already now a strong expression of interest for that event. I will talk about 5 points. Harold, is the acoustics okay? Do you hear me well? Okay. I will talk about concept. I will entertain you with a few pictures of bioeconomy products and so on. Get more serious regarding policy, strategies, theories, how to measure that thing, address the much debated resource competition and food security issues. Briefly, I understand we have discussion time, and then close with research agenda. Many of us look at structural transformation of the economy at country level or at global level with through this lens. How do the sector proportions of economies change? The line at the bottom is the share of agriculture in the global economy. It's now about 4% of GDP, still about 20% of jobs. Above that line is the share of industry, global GDP, and on top the share of services. Yes, this is a traditional way of looking at structural change. It assumes fundamentally that economies have structural priorities in terms of sectors. I question that. That's the very concept of a sector is still giving us a useful conceptual framework. Services have intruded agriculture. Industry and services are increasingly inseparable, not only in industrialized countries. I'm sort of ridiculing us, including myself, who have for years looked at this sectoral pattern Of course, agriculture's importance is much undervalued by GDP share. I don't need to go into that. The emerging bioeconomy is actually a cluster with interlinked value chains. We call it value webs. It's not a sector. I'm not talking to you about a new sector. I'm talking to you about a transformative thing, which is almost like what's happening with digitization, changing how economies work. If you want to stick to a sectoral structure, I have listed there subsets of sectors which are quite important for the bioeconomy, from agriculture to industry, textiles. In terms of value share, the pharmaceutical industries. So although I have a moment ago said, let's not try to talk the bioeconomy into a sector structure in order to sort of help you along from a sectoral frame of mind, I've listed that here. More relevant is this graph here on the right-hand side. Identifying primary production of food, feed, fiber, cellulosic crops, the industry with the fast-growing enzyme, biofuels, and bioplastic sectors, and the health with new therapies and diagnostic sectors. All that has very high value shares of bio-based industries. People who have thought about bioeconomy, I want to briefly acknowledge with this slide, and people who have done research which has paved the way for a lot of policy attention to bioeconomy. Georgescu Rogan was the first who applied thermodynamics to economics and spoke of bio-based economies. Paul Crutzen, with his research on the Anthropocene, gave us the theme of a new geological epoch in which humans alter the planet, changing its biological functions. You know the planetary boundary work from the Stockholm Environment and Research Institute. Steve Jobs, famous quote when he was unfortunately already very ill, arguing that I think the biggest innovations of the 21st century will be at the intersection of biology and technology. So he saw biologization and digitization as coming together. And I refer to the statements by Pope Francis, which you can read here on the slide. Of course, the Sustainable Development Goals, to which I will come in a moment towards the end of the talk, are also unachievable without heavy emphasis on bioeconomy. So why is this bioeconomy? Due to the sustainability concerns, the global bioeconomy must rebuild natural capital, improve the quality of life for a growing world population, and it should balance managing common goods such as air, water, and soil with economic expectations of people. So it drives towards coming to some form of acceptable harmony between humankind and nature in a 9 to 10 billion world. It requires at least three types of innovations: technological, institutional, and social. Let me give you what the German Bioeconomy Council, which I'm a co-chair of, has come up with defining the bioeconomy. I took some time to come to a definition. I didn't want to throw this right away at you. There are 20 other definitions of the bioeconomy, so but this has become more and more a consensus definition, which we have here. So bioeconomy is understood as the sustainable production and use of biological resources, biological processes, and biological principles to provide products and services in all economic sectors. I have listed here the ingredients, plants, microbes, animals, biodiversity, carbon as a raw material, biological knowledge, and so on. And down there, key sectors which drive and are driven by bioeconomy. So I underline bioeconomy is not bioenergy. Bioenergy is one ingredient of the bioeconomy. Bioeconomy is not dependent on biomass conversion. It's also based on biointelligence conversion into intelligent products and processes. Actually, the fastest growing bioeconomy subsector, the pharmaceutical sector, uses very little biomass, but a lot of biological intelligence. I promised you a few pictures. These are examples of consumer products. New tires based on little daisy type flowers. Actually, they are introduced and on the road, the rubber hits the road in Europe. Enzymes lowering effective washing temperatures, saving energy. Bioplastics, a huge theme. Implants made of spider fibers. Yeah, fix your rusty knee with spider fibers is already in the medical business. Bio-based building materials. I have another slide then. New sugar substitutes, biopharmaceuticals. 80% of pharmaceuticals in the world are now bio-based, and of course biofuels. I put that here among the others in order to underline it's just one out of many, many applications. Textiles could have been also shown. Important are changes of industrial processes in the bioeconomy, not only biorefineries and energetic use of waste, but also precision farming, the blue economy, much more than aquaculture of fish, controlled environment agriculture, phosphor recovery from wastewater, and CO2 as a feedstock of the 21st century. So get it out and get the carbon into all sorts of materials. We had a workshop 1.5 years ago in Beijing on, as the Chinese call it, bio-principled cities. So bioeconomy-based cities where the construction material is very much drawn out of biological resources. Wooden high-rise buildings, the buildings codes in Europe have been changed. You can are now permitted to build 10-story buildings from wood. Before it was only 3 stories. Because the modern wood fabrications with all sorts of enzyme in them are so sturdy and recyclable that there is a fast change in bio-based construction materials. But there are also high-tech bioeconomic solutions, such as in the computer industry, is a DNA-based computer where storage is not on silicon-based chips, but on neurons. The computer that can smell, you have probably read in the newspapers, based on neurons from the mouse, from mice, little rodents. Super materials based from straw, bio batteries. This picture you probably cannot see properly here. That's a lotus, the leaf of a lotus flower. And there's the biomimicry prototype of the wing of a new Airbus jet actually already manufactured. So copying nature is as much a bioeconomy, copying smartness of nature, as it is using biomass resources. 6 years ago, the world map of bioeconomy had maybe 3 or 4 flags. Countries didn't have bioeconomy strategies. It then went very fast that country after country wrote themselves bioeconomy research strategies and policy strategies. And you see, there are also quite a number who have done so in emerging economies. It's not only rich people's, rich countries' strategies. These strategies, however, differ. There are lots of different bioeconomies, plural, emerging around the world. Some are, actually the majority, are sort of high-tech. That's the gray part there. Some are very much innovation, high-tech, research-based. Quite a number have bioenergy-driven bioeconomy strategies. It's a mixed picture where especially you find many who are more resource-based and others who are more knowledge-based, a knowledge-based bioeconomy. Bioeconomy is endogenous. It's not just by postulation of policymakers. It's driven by major changes in the resource conditions and availabilities, by consumer preferences, especially the global middle class is driving a driving force, new science breakthroughs, and sustainability concerns, which probably are part of number two, the consumer preferences. And as policy has entered the game of with all these flag-waving bioeconomy strategies, which I've shown you a moment ago, there is a feedback mechanism between policy strategies and driving the science and technology. So heavy investments in science and technology gives you breakthroughs, gives opportunities, and changes opportunities in industries and influences consumers. It's a much debated question, how do we measure this thing, this bioeconomy thing? I point here to a recent article by Justus Wesseler and myself, which just came out, and we distinguish between these three ways of measuring. The simple one is, of course, try to measure it as a share of GDP or number of jobs in the bioeconomy. Then you would have to do what I have rejected at the very beginning of this talk, treat bioeconomy as a piece of a puzzle of sectors. But still, people do that. It gives you in many economies bioeconomy shares, such as in the German one of 15% to 18%, and so much more significant than what you call agriculture. But I don't like that approach. Even less I would like the second one, sort of a physiocratic physical measurement, how much of renewable bio-based content is in products and services. Yeah? That has no economics, but again, people do that. Yeah? You measure it in biomass content. What I think we need to do is number three, measure the outcomes of the bioeconomy in terms of reduced emissions, sustainable water, soil, and biodiversity, and ultimately well-being and health of people. This is not all a happy story. Bioeconomy is not per se sustainable and is not per se good. things can go wrong, bioeconomy needs to be designed so that more or less the welfare goals with which I was just referring in the previous slide are achieved. The challenges are that there are new economy-wide competitions for biomass, complementarities in the value chains, and the big question, can small guys, small farmers in particular, participate? And how does bioeconomy relate to the 17 Sustainable Development Goals? In my opinion, most of the SDGs are unachievable without a bio-based economy, a sustainable bio-based, well-designed economy. With a little bit of recycling, it cannot be done. I've listed here those which are in particular dependent on a vibrant, innovative bioeconomy, including, of course, the climate change, climate actions, and responsible consumption and production. The bioeconomy has a consumption side, not only a production side. There are conflicting goals in the bioeconomy between food and feed, ecology and nature, and biomass use. That these conflicting goals are for real, we know from the excessive subsidization and quota systems of bioenergy, which was an element of the food price increases in the times of 2007, 8, 9. Rajul, you remember. We were still here. There's also a complex problem related to what climate change does to the global distribution of biomass. This is somewhat outdated, but there isn't a more recent estimate of the trends of the global distribution of biomass. That was an article in Science. Where it is reddish in this map, you see declines in biomass. And you see that this is also the case in parts of Africa and Latin America, South America, where one would assume, wow, there is a mega location for making high value out of biomass. So we need to watch that. And we need to watch the other global problem, the one of land and soil degradation, where it is reddish on this map. From our work at the Center for Development Research, you see increased anthropogenic degradation of land. And in those pixels, there are very few green areas where things got better. So we need to watch this. And we need to do a lot of policy research, and I hope IFBRI colleagues get turned on to that. Protecting and enhancing food security in the context of the emerging bioeconomy, including policy actions in the field of R&D, zero waste initiatives, market orientation in biofuels pricing, standard setting, efficiency improvement in traditional bioenergy and next generations, and so on. There are African opportunities. And you have seen there are a few countries in Africa who have become attracted to green growth and bio-based industry, bioeconomy strategies. South Africa was the first already 6 years ago, but in the meantime also others. It's not only because of the large resource base, the jobs in rural areas are attractive, because value addition may be there. The growing science system in Africa is a good basis, and there are a few new policy initiatives. Let me close by a couple of remarks on doing doing more explanation on what should be the research agenda. After all, we are at IFPRI and talking about research agenda. We did a Delphi study in 2015 with hundreds of people who know something about bioeconomy, so a two-round study with adjustment opportunities by those who we asked in the first round. And we are doing something like that again now. Maybe some of you are on the distribution list. You should be on that. If not, I send it to you. It's still ongoing. So what did the global expert community say should be the top-notch research areas in the field of bioeconomy? They argued for a lot more bioeconomy research with citizens and consumers to change demand patterns. Biorefineries 4.0 is sort of a traditional agenda getting modern. Bioprincipled cities, I talked about that. New food systems, very close to IFPRI's heart. Sustainable marine production, so the blue bioeconomy, we call that. And artificial photosynthesis, changing the photosynthesis mechanics. What nature has given us on on photosynthesis is rather inefficient. A small improvement in photosynthesis could make a huge difference, not just for bioenergy, or less so for bioenergy, also the quality will be substantially changed of photosynthesis products. There are big initiatives on artificial photosynthesis in the US, in Europe, and China, Japan. India's strongly interested. I have not heard in Africa about that. This was the communique of the final statement of the Global Bioeconomy Summit a couple of years ago. I don't need to walk you through that. We will revisit that at the next Global Bioeconomy Summit, which will be focused a lot more on an innovation agenda, including innovation in industry in the private sector. But number two, making bioeconomy's contributions to sustainable development goals measurable and really making it as part of translating the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, into action, that has been adopted by lots of countries which were present at the last Global Bioeconomy Summit. So I said I would invite you. Here's the invitation. Click it on. I hope to see at least some of you in Berlin in April next year, and thank you for your attention.